Okay. Hi, everybody. Thank you so much for coming today. So let me introduce Noreen. N.M. Cedeño is the current president of Sisters in Crime, Heart of Texas chapter. She's the graduate of the University of Texas at Austin, who writes mystery novels and short stories that are typically set in Texas. Her mysteries vary from traditional to romantic suspense and from paranormal to science fiction. Her short story entitled A Reasonable Expectation of Privacy tied for third place for best short story in the 2013 Analog Readers Poll. Her novel For the Children's Sake was selected as a finalist for a book award by the East Texas Writers Guild in 2016. She's currently working on a paranormal mystery series called Bad Vibes Removal Services while sheltering from the pandemic at her home in Round Rock with her Ecuadorian husband, three teenagers, and German Shepherd mixed dog. Her latest novel entitled Degrees of Deceit, the second book in the Bad Vibes series, came out in 2019. Her latest short stories in the series, Arson Vibes and Other Tales, came out in April 2020. So thank you so much for being with us today.
Thank you so much for hosting us. That is Maureen at the West Bank Library, and she hosts our meetings, and we thank her very much for it.
You just lost me.
I get to make a few announcements first before we get started. The newsletter is out. It's posted on our Facebook page, our Twitter feed, and our webpage. And it's got information on upcoming meetings and all sorts of other fun things in there for you to look at. So if you haven't seen our newsletter, the July-August newsletter is out. Next month, we will have Lori Rader Day coming to talk. Lori Rader Day is the national president of Sisters in Crime. She is an award-winning mystery author. She has a new book out. She's going to tell us about her new book. She will talk about Sisters in Crime, and she will answer any questions that you have. Let's see here. Oh, there's an online mystery conference on July 25th, Murder in the Midlands. It's free for Sisters in Crime members, and I think we have a link to it on our webpage and possibly in our newsletter. I'll double check, but we've sent that out before. If you want to attend, it looks like it's going to be very interesting, and it's free for Sisters in Crime members, so all you have to do is register. Let's see, finally, we had a request from the Pflugerville Library that if there are any of our authors who would like to do virtual events, they're looking for authors to do virtual events. So contact me, send me an email if you're interested, and I will put you in contact with the Pflugerville Library. All right. Are y'all ready to get started? I'm gonna get my presentation up for y'all. We will talk about how to submit your work to magazines, contests, and anthologies. Okay. Boom. Let's see. All right, can y'all see that? Give me a thumbs up or something. Yay. All right, let's see here. Okay. So what I'm about to cover, while it's aimed for fiction works, short stories, flash fiction, and things like that, it can also apply to poetry, essays, memoir, anything that you might want to submit to a contest or an anthology or a magazine. So the rules. Robert Heinlein was a science fiction writer, and he had five rules. I have pared them down to four. The first rule, you must write. The second, you must finish what you start. The third is, you have to put it on the market. And the fourth is, be persistent and resubmit repeatedly. Now, Heinlein's third rule was, do not revise except to editorial direction. And I'm not that good. Apparently he could, you know, create perfect first drafts, but I'm not that person. I have to revise. So I dropped his third rule. His last rule was resubmit until the story sells. And that's what I mean by be persistent, because you will have to resubmit your work. I'm not going to tell you how to write. Every writer writes differently. It's whatever your process is, use your process, but you have to finish and then you have to put it on the market. Okay, so the first thing you need to know if you're going to submit anything to anthologies or contests is that you should expect rejection. Getting a rejection doesn't mean your work is bad. It only means that to somebody somewhere, it wasn't the right choice at that moment in time. You have to resubmit. You have to resubmit repeatedly, over and over and over again. Thousands of people are submitting their work for publication every day, and most of those pieces aren't going to be selected. So every author is going to receive rejection notices. And so you have to learn to not let those get you down. Don't say, oh no, they don't like it, and throw it in a drawer and never resubmit, because you will never get anything published that way. You have to keep trying. I just read blogs this week by some professional short story writers who are multi-published in Hitchcock magazine, Ellery Queen magazine, a number of anthologies. One of them was celebrating because a story he'd submitted 14 times had finally been picked up. Another said it took him 22 times to get a story accepted. And those are the professionals who sell lots of stories. So,
were they submitting to the same publication over and over?
No.
Okay.
Different ones. Okay, so you have to resubmit. You have to keep finding markets and keep finding places to submit that story. And eventually somebody will say, oh, this fits what we're looking for. Now, you may not see a place to resubmit it immediately. You may see a call for submissions next year or the year after. But keep trying to submit that piece of work. Okay, so you're going to be rejected. This is not bad failure. This is good failure. Good failure means you made an attempt and you tried. Not trying, that's failure. Putting it in the drawer and never showing it to anybody again, that's failure. You have to keep trying. Rejection isn't an indicator that the work is bad. It might be an indicator that you sent it to the wrong place, but we'll get into that later. So what does a rejection letter look like? If you're afraid of being rejected, don't be afraid they're gonna tell you, oh, this was awful, stop writing, stop submitting. They don't say that. There are different kinds of rejection letters, and I'm gonna show you some. Oh, first, before I get to them. These are just some books showing how many times these people submitted and got rejected, and these are classics. If classics get rejected 10 and 20 and 30 times, everybody gets rejected. Remember that. Okay. So here's an example of a kind of personal rejection letter. I submitted a short story to a VoucherCon contest last year. It had two rounds of judging, and from the second round, they chose the finalists. I think there were four of them. My story made it to the second round, and they said, sorry, you didn't make it to the final. That's fine. It's a friendly letter. Thank you. Best wishes. That's a pretty common rejection, personal rejection letter. This is a generic one. So Hitchcock Magazine, I've submitted them I don't know how many times. I haven't got in yet. I hope to someday. I've replaced the name of the story with blah, blah, blah in this letter, but this is their basic rejection letter. Don't be afraid of these letters. They don't bite. They don't say give up and quit. All right, so now that we have covered rejection, now we're gonna figure out how to work for success. We're gonna talk about submitting the work. So before you can figure out where to submit, you have to have actually written something. Have you written flash fiction? Do you write short stories? Have you got a novelette, a novella, or maybe a novel? Do you know the difference between those different lengths of stories? Because different venues, different markets will ask for different lengths. So here's some handy definitions of what those things are. Flash fiction is typically only a few hundred words, less than 1,000. A short story is usually, there's some variability in this, 1,000 to say 8,000. Some places will define it as 1,000 to 5,000. But I've seen calls for short stories up to 8,000 words easily. A novelette, 8,000 to say 15,000. A novella, 20,000 to 50,000. And a novel is usually over 50,000 words. These numbers change if you are writing for children. Middle grade novels are much shorter, unless, well, Harry Potter books and some of the Paolini books on dragons. Those are monster books, but for the most part, kids' books are shorter. So then, more handy definitions you need to know before we get into this. What kind of markets are there? Markets for short stories in magazines and anthologies, they're defined by how they pay you. A professional market is one that's paying 6 to 8 cents a word, usually. I've seen as high as 10. There are a few that'll even pay more than that, but it's usually for very short lengths. A semi-professional market is a market that pays between 3 and 5.99 cents a word. A paying market, this is just, it's a very small payment, a cent to 2.9 cents a word. A token market, usually it's going to be some very minimum payment, or they're going to give you a copy of the printed form, and that's your payment. We'll give you a free copy. Anthologies pay differently. They're all, some of them pay royalties, some of them pay a minimum amount for the story plus royalties, but their pay is different, so you have to look at them separately. All right, so where do you find places to submit your work? There are writer blogs where people collect and post calls for submissions. And there are tracking websites that the magazines will go to and say, hey, put our call for submissions up there for us. The first one I have here for you is a writer website. It's publishtodeath.blogspot.com. The name of the website is, I think, Publishing and Other Forms of Insanity. And on there, you'll find a tab for open calls for submissions. Now, the author who runs that, she organizes them by deadline. So you'll find January calls, February calls, March, April, May, June, and it's by month of the year that she's got them organized. But they're not in any other order by genre, by pay. They could be essays, screenplays, poetry calls, all sorts of things. She just puts them all, they're by deadline. Now my favorite place to look is thegrinder.diabolicalplots.com. It's also called the Submission Grinder. On the website, it'll say the grinder at the top and it's got a picture of a meat grinder and I'll show it to you later, but this is a business that tracks and identifies markets. You can do searches by genre, by pay, by all sorts of different variables. And the website, it kind of looks like it escaped Windows 3.1 from 1993, but it's very functional and very easy to use. It doesn't require a login to use it, but if you do create a login, then you can use their software to track your own submissions, which you need to be doing. So if you don't use one of these websites to track your submissions, then you should have like a spreadsheet or something to show where have I submitted this work. So, because you need to keep track of how many times you submit and where you're submitting. The next place to look, Submittable. So discover.submittable.com is a third party where different magazines and places will go and post their calls for submissions. It's searchable by genre. You do have to have a login to get into this. They make you create a login, but it is free. Submittable is also a submission system. So different magazines may have you email or use a submission system to submit a piece of work, but if they don't have their own, then they contract with a third party company like Submittable to be the submission system. So Submittable, you can find the call for submissions and submit your work through that website, which is why you have to have a login for it. This is another author's website, raylan.com. He just is kind enough to keep it out there and have information for people who want to submit work. He sorts it by professional, semi-pro, token, flash, fiction, and a couple of other categories, and gives you information like who's the editor, what's the word count, what's the response time, and it's just very brief little information about each open market. Okay, the other place to look is on the various writers' organizations' websites. Mystery Writers of America, Science Fiction, Fantasy Writers of America, all these groups will keep lists of markets that are considered acceptable professional markets to submit your work to. I know our newsletter, if you look at our newsletter, I will search out and find calls for submissions, and I'll put them in our newsletter. In fact, the one that came out yesterday has three or four upcoming calls for submissions in it that are coming. The deadlines are in the, one of them's this week, next week, and another one's in August, but they're in there. And we also post those on our Facebook page for you. Okay. So once you go through all of those places and you find just dozens of places to submit your work, how do you sort all these options? Well, first thing you do, if you've got magazines that you recognize and know, oh, I know this place, I've heard of this place, I really want to submit there, then start with the one that pays you the most. Don't send your best work to a token market that is not going to pay you hardly anything. Send it to the top level first, because you don't want to sell something to a token market that could have potentially reached a professional level market. So start at the top, work your way down. If you've found contests and markets you've never heard of, those require very, very, very careful sifting. When you look at these things, remember that there are people who are going to try and take your work and not pay you. They would rather get something for nothing. There are people who want to make money off of you. There are any number of things that look like legitimate contests that are not legitimate. There are any number of places that look like legitimate publishers that are not legitimate publishers. You have to make sure you know where you're submitting your work. Generally speaking, look for things where the money flows to the author, not to the company. There are a lot of contests that are very legitimate that have entry fees, but you can go broke submitting to contests with entry fees only. If I'm going to submit to a contest with an entry fee, I'd like to get something back for it, such as some of them have critique or feedback that they give you. Look for those. Look for something where if you're going to put a fee in there, that they're going to at least give you something back in return, because really it's better. If you're going to put your work out there, that you get paid for it and not that you're supporting somebody else's business. So, about those scams, how do you check for scams? Would you let a contractor come into your house and start work when you have not background checked them? No! Go online, do a search for complaints about different contests, do a search for, is this company a scam? Is this company a fraud? One of the best places to check, Science Fiction and Fantasy Writers of America has it for you. It's Writer Beware. It's a website that puts notices of different scams and things to be aware of that are out there trying to rip off writers. Okay. So once you've gone through all these things, you've checked to make sure you have a legitimate market. Next, you got to look at what the requirements are for submitting. Are there submission fees? Contests charge them. Magazines should never charge a submission fee. If it's, that's a big red flag if they want you to have a submission fee to read or publish your work. So now you know what's legitimate. You've found like 10 markets and you've started at the top. You've got three professional level markets that you want to submit your work to. How do you know which one to submit to first? Well, each market is going to try and carve out a niche. They're going to choose stories that match the tone and niche that they've got. Hitchcock for mystery magazines, they're dark, they're suspenseful. Ellery Queen tends to take more lighter stories, traditional stories. They've got a feel to each magazine that they are trying to match your story to. If you're a science fiction writer, Asimov's would take science fiction and fantasy that are lighter. Analog wants things to be very scientifically accurate. So they're not going to take anything that has more fantasy in it. Match your story to the tone of the magazine. And the best way to do that is to read that market, read those stories that are being published by those magazines. So you know, okay, yeah, my story kind of fits in with these. This is a good place to submit. So that will give you your best chance for publication if you try and match the tone of the magazine. All right, so now you've matched the tone. You've ruled out the scams. You've chosen the professional ones. Next thing to do is read the guidelines. Some places will allow you to submit simultaneous submissions. So this will speed up your chances of getting something published if you can submit to multiple markets at once. Other places will say, no, we only want you to submit to us and nobody else, no simultaneous submissions. Read the guidelines and see if it's allowed. Some places, Hitchcock and Ellery Queen will not allow you to submit to both of them at once. You must choose one first and then the other. All right, multiple submissions. Most places will not allow you to send more than one story at a time. You send one piece, only your best work. If you are, for example, a poet, poetry magazines may ask for 4 or 5 at once. They will allow multiple submissions. It kind of depends on the market. But most short story markets for fiction only want one story at a time, no multiple submissions. Okay, next in the guidelines, you will find formatting information. Hitchcock and Ellery Queen generally say to use William Shun's manuscript format. This is a very basic professional format to put your manuscript in. And if you find a magazine that doesn't specify format, go ahead and use William Shun's format because it makes your work look professional. Others will say specifically, instead of William Shun, they'll say, oh, we want Times New Roman and we want it double spaced with 1-inch margins. Whatever it says, follow the guidelines. Other magazines, Sherlock Holmes cracks me up because they will make you jump through hoops with their submission guidelines. They are very specific on word usage. They don't want you to say try and in your document. It must be trying to, because they feel like that's a more proper use of the term. They don't want you to use the word all right as one word. It has to be two. They don't want you to use any more as one word. It has to be two. So you have to go through your manuscript and make sure your word usage matches their submission guidelines. I think some magazines use this kind of little nitpicky rules to try and weed people out. So be sure and read carefully what they want before you submit. Once you've got your submission formatted the way that's requested, you're gonna find most of them want a cover letter. So the cover letter, you should write your cover letter in advance and make sure that it is free of errors. It should include the title of your work, the word count. Poems, they want line counts usually, but essays, short stories, novels, they want word count. It will want your publishing history. And if you don't have any, don't worry about it. Just skip that. It'll want a brief biographical statement. And finally, it's usually a good thing to put your professional associations in there. So members of Sisters in Crime say, I'm an active member of Sisters in Crime. This is a signal to the person reading the cover letter that you are a member of the writing community, that you take this seriously, and that you have gone through what you need to do to learn what you need to learn to be submitting to their magazine. Okay, so now you've got your cover letter, you've got your formatted document. Time to submit. Some magazines or anthologies, or they're smaller, they'll give you an email address and say, please submit your file as an attachment to this, to an email to this address. In that case, your cover letter will be the email. You'll attach the file and you'll send it. Others will have a submission system. They'll go through Submittable or Moksha is another one I've seen, or they may have their own system. Mystery Weekly, for example, has a form you fill out where you copy and paste your entire document into a box on their website rather than attaching a file. So whatever their system says to do, you have to follow the directions. Generally, they're going to want your email address, your name, what pseudonym you're writing under, and then they'll have you attach the cover letter in a box and then attach the file. Now, for the file, the system will tell you what file format they'll accept. Some of them will only take a .doc. Some of them will only take a .docx. So make sure you save your file in the correct format, because I've made this mistake before. I kept trying to hit submit and it wouldn't submit. And it was because I had a .doc instead of a .docx, or vice versa. Okay, so you've hit submit or send, and the document has gone and it's out there to the contest or the anthology or the magazine. Now what? Now you get to wait for somebody to respond to you. Some markets will tell you on their websites, if you don't hear from us in 3 months, consider that a rejection. There are too many submissions for us to get back to. We're not gonna get back to you. That's just how they work. Others respond to everybody. But it may take them up to a year to respond. Hitchcock, Alfred Hitchcock Mystery Magazine is currently taking, I think, 10 months, but they read everything that they get. Some companies may respond to you in a matter of days or weeks because they don't have openings, or the length of story you sent them doesn't fit whatever length they currently have left available in their magazine. So don't be hurt if you get an instant rejection right back. They probably didn't open it. They probably looked at your word count and saw it didn't fit, and or saw that they had too many stories on this topic already, or whatever. If you get a very quick rejection, that's okay. You tried that market, move on to the next one. Some of the magazines and contests will say, expect to hear back from us by this date. Others, like I said, won't post anything. But if you can't find on their website how long to expect to hear back from them, you can find reliable response times on the submission grinder. They collect data from authors who say, okay, I submitted on this date and I heard back on this date. And they keep that data accessible to authors to look at. So you can kind of gauge how long to expect to hear back. And I can show you what that looks like. So this is the submission grinder. This is the response time page for Alfred Hitchcock Mystery Magazine. As you can see, here we go. Right here, the minimum 186 days, mean average 307 days, median 306, the max 414. 3.7% of people were accepted, 88.8% were rejected, because remember, most people are going to get rejections. It says dead letters here for 7%. those, it shows were withdrawn. That means the author, for whatever reason, maybe the story got accepted someplace else, they withdrew that story before the magazine either accepted or rejected it. You go down here, this is the response turnaround chart for Alfred Hitchcock Mystery Magazine. You can see the vast majority of people hear back from the magazine between 280 and 320 days after submission. And this is pretty accurate. This is about how long it's been taking. I have a story with them right now. I submitted it last October. I expect I'll hear back August, September. And generally when I've submitted to them, this has been very accurate in how long it takes to hear back from them. Okay, so suppose you get an acceptance. With a contest, you may just hear, yay, you won, congratulations. Other than that though, mostly acceptances take a lot longer and they're more likely to say, hi, we really liked your story and we might like to publish it, but we think that there are a few things that can be improved. So then you get to work with the editor of the magazine or the anthology, and they will tell you what you need to do to get your story published in that magazine. These changes, they might be some simple little tweaks. They might be something more difficult. One of my stories, the one that I had that went to analog, I heard back from the editor, Stanley Schmidt, and he said, hi, I really liked your story. However, and remember, analog has to be very scientifically accurate. He said, the angle of refraction of the material that you used in your story was too great to have the effect you want in the story. Therefore, I suggest you replace what you used with something made up. Just make up a name for it. Like, okay, I can do that. No problem. That's an easy fix. So I did that and I sent it back to him and he said, great, this is almost there. I think the only thing you need to do now is add a little more conflict to your climax. And I went, okay. Because that's a lot harder to do. But I did. And then I resubmitted it to him again. And eventually he said, yes, this is what we want. We will be publishing it. And they send you a copy of it and you get to review it word by word to make sure it says what you want it to say and what they want it to say. And then it is time for you as an author to take off your author hat and put on your business person hat and start thinking about licensing and copywriting. Because when somebody says, hey, we'd like to publish your work, you are not selling your work. You are licensing your work. Your short story is a piece of intellectual property. The value of that property is in its licensing, and you need to see what they want to license from you. Now, when you create your work, from the moment you create it, the copyright is yours. However, you must register that copyright in order to claim damages if someone uses it without your consent. So copyright.gov, you can go there. There's a small fee, $35 to $55, depending on what it is, as the last I saw it at. I need to go back and look. You claim your copyright for your story, and they will send you a document documenting that it is your copyright. Okay, so the magazine, the anthology, they'll send you a contract to license them to publish your story. You are licensing your story in a printed, readable format to a magazine. There are other ways to license a story. So your contract with that magazine should generally just say, for a printed version, every once in a while they'll ask for audio too, but there are other ways to license what you have there. You can license your story as a video game, a board game, an audiobook, a television show or movie or short feature. There's foreign language translations, because generally speaking, the contracts want first English language rights, not French, not Spanish, not South American Portuguese versus Portugal Portuguese. There are different versions of foreign translation rights. You can get it licensed into a podcast. Characters, toys, lunchboxes. If you're Harry Potter, you've got theme parks that your story's licensed for. So different licenses will be covered by different contracts, generally speaking. Now, they'll send you that contract, and that contract should specify the rights they want to license from you, for what time period, and whether it's an exclusive or a non-exclusive license. So here are some examples taken from some websites. This is for, I believe, Black Beacon Books. So they want first world English rights. First world English rights means your story cannot have appeared on your blog, cannot be in somebody's critique site that's published online. It cannot be anywhere but with them for the first time in English. They don't want it out there in any other version. All the rights will revert to the author after publication, which means once they've published their anthology, your rights revert to you and you can republish that story however you want. Now, here's another license to look at. This one wants first publication and archival rights with an exclusivity period of 1 year. Exclusivity period of 1 year means they don't want you to publish that story anywhere else for 1 year after they publish it. They want the rights to be the only one who has it out there for 1 year. You'll notice they also want it on their website and social media excerpts and possibly in a printed collection. And they've asked for archival rights because they want it on their website and they want people to be able to search for it. Here's another statement I found. World English in print, digital and audio exclusive for 5 years. Now in theory, they should pay you more for wanting it for 5 years and for wanting audio too, but you have to look at the contract. You have to see what they're willing to give you for that. These are all taken from contests, anthologies, and magazines. These are not for novels. Novels are a totally different, wholly different world than short submissions. So for the contracts, if you don't understand part of it, get some help. The Science Fiction Writers of America has an intro to publishing contracts on their website. They even have a sample contract for you to compare your contract to make sure that it is considered to be a reasonable standard contract for the industry, that it is not trying to scam you out of rights that you may not want to give up. That's important because I've seen things that are major contests that just by submitting to them, you could be granting them the copyright indefinitely. And that's terrifying. So read any contract that you get or terms and conditions if it's a contest before you submit and before you sign on the dotted line, know what you are signing away. Okay. This is because copyright currently lasts your life plus 70 years. For books, novels, the big publishers generally want your copyright, the right to publish your book for the copyright, the life of the copyright, which means your great-grandchildren could potentially be the ones dealing with the company that you signed the contract with, or whoever they sold the contract to after you died. Next, so don't be naive, know what you're signing. Make sure that you're looking at your expirations for exclusivity and how long they want your work. Be sure if you're signing a book contract that you get somebody to go over with you. Don't let somebody tell you it's a standard contract and make you feel stupid and powerless. This is how they steal things from you. For an example, Taylor Swift last year had a big to-do over her music because the person she signed a contract to distribute her work for her when she was 16 and has the right to distribute her work for the life of the copyright sold that right to someone she hates. And there's nothing she can do about that because she signed that contract when she was 16. That happens to musicians all the time. It's happening to authors with their books more and more frequently. Know what you were signing. One author, Christine Catherine Rush, has a great series on her blog covering contracts, negotiating, what kind of deal breakers to look for. So be an intelligent business person, get out there, read the science fiction writer's website, check out other authors who have put out their information for authors to know about contracts, know what you're signing. And if you do not feel competent to go through the doublespeak of a lawyer's contract by yourself, absolutely get an intellectual property lawyer to review a contract for you. Especially if there's something in there that looks suspicious, get a lawyer to look it over for you. A lot of people have agents and they'll say, oh, my agent looked at it for me, it's good. Okay, an agent is there to know if a story will sell. They do not have a law license. They're gonna go with whatever their boss told them to do. It's like, oh, this is what the company gave us, this is what we're giving them. They are not there to give you legal advice, and they're just gonna go with what they're told. Get a lawyer, not an agent, to review your contracts. Okay. Where are we? Ways to improve as a writer. Join a group, join a critique group. Writers League of Texas has classes. Read, read, read the industry, and write, 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 write. Here are some upcoming current calls for submissions. Malice Domestic is one of the big conventions for mystery writers. Normally they would be held in person. This year we have coronavirus canceling Malice Domestic, canceling, well, not canceling, but everything's gone online. VoucherCon, for example, is online in the fall. Both VoucherCon and Malice Domestic every year put out a call for submissions for their anthologies. So every year you can go onto those convention websites and look, what's the anthology gonna be this year? And see if you have a story to submit or if you have time to write a story to fit into their anthology theme and submit. Malice Domestics is Murder Most Diabolical. They've had Murder Most Edible. They've had a wide variety of themes for their anthologies. So you'll need to have a short story to go with the theme. And you can reliably expect those anthologies to come out every year. So look for them to find a place to submit. Black Beacon Books has a call right now for Murder and Machinery. That closes January 31st. It's short stories that are similar to, say, The Pit and the Pendulum. Things where something is threatening a person's life. So there are a little bit of horror, a little bit of terror, suspense, but it's murder with some sort of machinery is what they're looking for. The Staunch Short Story Prize is open right now. It closes in, less than 10 days. They're looking for thrillers that do not in any way, shape, or form put a woman's life in danger. So they don't want your suspense to be built on some woman being stalked, threatened, or murdered. They want it to be built on something else. Cozy Villages of Death, that one closes in a couple of days. They're looking for short stories in the style of, say, Murder, She Wrote, where you have a small town, where you have an amateur sleuth working maybe with the local police department to solve some sort of a story in a little village. It can be a mountain village, a seaside village. It doesn't have to be an English village, but that one's open right now too. Let me see here, what else have I got for you? Oh, I was gonna go to questions, but before we do that, let me show you the submission grinder. I'm gonna take you over there. Give me just a second. Hold on. I may need to find it over here. Give me a second. Oh, there it is. Go back here. Share. All right, so this is the submission grinder. As you see, like I said, looks like it's from Windows 3.1, 1993. But this search function right here, you can do a search for any genre. Mystery and crime is here. Suspense and thriller is also here separately. Suppose you choose mystery and crimes. If you have a short story already written and you know your word count, you can put your word count right there and it'll find you all the different places that are looking for short stories with those word counts. If you just are looking for, you've got lots of things written, then you can stick with any length, or you can change that to flash if you specify, if you're a flash fiction person, or short story if you've got short stories. Let's stick with any length for now. Type of submission. Some of them still allow you to mail a manuscript. There are very few, but if you were looking for those, you can find them here. I usually say any type because I don't care if it's mail-in or electronic. A market qualification, if it's an award-winning market, something that's been published in that contest or magazine or anthology, won an award, or is recognized by the science fiction writers as a legitimate market, you can choose those markets. I usually go for any qualification. I don't worry about, if you put in zero here, it'll give you only the ones that pay, but then you're likely to miss the ones that are questionable, like where there isn't a set pay because it's royalties. So I usually don't put anything there. And then you can sort by name, by pay scale, by response time. I like to do by pay scale. You could choose anthologies only. You can choose contests only. When you hit, it's gonna not give you automatically things that are temporarily closed, permanently closed, fee-based, things that make you sign up for a newsletter, and anything with a non-standard contract. So they're very good about trying to help you make sure you get legitimate markets. So then you hit search and it takes a second, usually with some funny little saying there, before it shows you all these lovely markets by pay, and it'll tell you over here the average response time. So here's Ellery Queen. They take novelettes, novellas, flash fiction, and short stories, different times of the year. Ellery Queen also has a Department of First Mysteries, First Stories. So if you've never been published before, you can submit to their Department of First Stories and you'll have a better chance of getting in because you're competing only with the beginners then. Let's see. When you click on their magazine, it shows you a little blurb about what they're looking for. It gives you links to their website and to their guidelines that you can click directly over to the website and see the magazine's guidelines. It tells you what genres they take, the lengths, and their approximate pay. Now, I know for a fact that Ellery Queen and Hitchcock will pay more if you are an established author, 8 to 10 cents for authors who've been published before. It'll tell you, do they take electronic submissions? Yes. Postal submissions, reprints, multiple submissions, simultaneous submissions. And then it'll tell you what their website says is their response time. However, then it'll have their response data down at the bottom here. These are all the people who've submitted something to Ellery Queen. And Ben, the red is rejection, purple is pending, green is an acceptance. They responded to 100%, They accepted 2.46% on an average of 113 days, and they rejected 97% within 23 days. So to see the reject, to see how quickly they respond, go to the response turnaround chart. You'll see most people are rejected by Ellery Queen quite quickly. Acceptances, you have to work with the editor, you have to make corrections. They're much more likely to take a longer period of time. So, and this is another reason I love this website, because you have these statistics at the tip of your fingers to see what to expect and what percentage of people are being accepted. They also, by the way, they have poetry markets. You can search by name if you know a magazine you want to look for. So it's a fun website to work with in order to find places to submit to. Let me see here. I can show you also. Now let's do it by name. Search. There's their little thing while they pull it up. I mentioned Cozy Villages of Death. It's right there. You'll see it's got no data yet. That is because it is an anthology with a close date that hasn't come up yet. So it'll have, looks like one person has submitted to this already. We don't, it's still pending. We don't have acceptances. We don't have any of this data because it is an anthology and the close date hasn't come up yet. Okay, and you see it's royalties only for the pay. All right. What questions do y'all have for me?
Noreen.
Yes.
One question did come up in the chat box that says, do you copyright before you submit?
Copyright before? No. Usually I do it after. It's entirely up to the author, though. Whatever you want to do, if you want to copyright it before you show it to anybody, that's fine. If you want to copyright it right before you publish it, that's fine too. Anybody else?
So if you copyright it and then you make edits to it, what does that do to the copyright? I'm just curious.
There's a preliminary copyright option for manuscripts. And you can, I believe, update it to a published version option. So if you've just got the manuscript, you can choose the preliminary copyright for the manuscript. But it should be fine.
With those pay rates, does anybody make a living writing?
It depends on the person and how often they submit. Like I said, I mentioned that blog where I read, it's called Sleuthsayers. There are people on there who've published 30 and 40 and 50 short stories with professional paying magazines. I don't know if they also publish books. Some of them do. So yes, there are people who make a living off writing and do it well, but they are very good business people. And they're probably have multiple streams of incomes from their writing. For example, if you have licensed your work to something like a podcast or a game or something, then you're more likely to have multiple streams of incomes from the same piece of work. Anybody else?
This isn't exactly a question, but I submitted to that Cozy Mysteries of Death.
Sure.
And it showed only one submission?
Oh, okay. So there are probably lots of other people out there who submitted to it. But that one, that's the people who have chosen to be tracked by Submission Grinder.
Oh, okay. Okay. I'm in for sure then.
No, it's just the people who've chosen to give their data to Submission Grinder. If you log in there and create a login and put the day you submitted, then you would be on there too. But you have to personally choose to put that data on there.
Very good.
It's helpful if you don't want to keep your own spreadsheet of stories and keep track of where you've submitted everything, because the submission grader will track all that stuff for you and keep it. Did I submit here? Oh, look, I did back then, because most places won't allow you to resubmit.
Right, and I haven't done any submitting of short stories in a long time, but I'm thinking of starting it up again.
Oh, well, good. Good luck.
I write novels and self-publish, but.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Do we have any other questions? I know I went through that kind of fast. I was sorry about that, talking kind of fast.
It was a great presentation.
Very good.
Yeah, very good. I do have an addition to add to your list, if you like it.
Sure.
Although it's a paid subscription, it's called Duotrope.
Yeah, I've heard of Duotrope. I left it off because I don't pay.
Yeah. Well, it's another, option.
I know.
I don't know if Grindr looks a lot like it, but I don't know if Grindr, if you can go, there's interviews with all the editors and the publishers on Duotrope. So you mentioned,
They don't have that on Grindr.
You mentioned that to be sure your submission matches what they're looking for, what their genre is, and that sort of thing. And Duotrope does offer that. And it's $50 a year.
So that's not bad, but.
No. There's a lot more that are a lot more expensive. But great presentation. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, you're welcome.
Anybody
else have any other questions?
Thank you.
Well, who said they have a question?
I have a question. You self-publish, is there less chance they'll publish a short story, even though it's a different story?
No. Not at all. Self-publishing is fine as long as it's not the same story. If it's a completely different story, it doesn't matter.
Maureen, can you make your presentation available?
I can. I believe Maureen is going to put it up on the West Bank Library's site.
Okay.
Maureen, would you care to answer that?
Yeah, if it's okay with you, I was going to, I'm recording it, and I can put it up on the library YouTube page probably later today or tomorrow. And if you'd like me to, I can also do a Facebook post advertising that it's up there.
Okay.
So yes, it will be available on the library website, on their YouTube page. Anybody else?
You were great.
This is good.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you very much. Let me see if I have anything else for y'all. As I mentioned, next month we have Lori Rader. I'm very much looking forward to her coming. She's the national president of Sisters in Crime. And she also has a new book out, and she is an award-winning author. She will be talking about her new book. She will answer some questions about Sisters in Crime. So come prepared for a great presentation, because she's a good speaker.
And Noreen, just for the record, everybody, we do have the schedule for the rest of the year now planned out. So it's very exciting. And let's see, next August, that's yours. September, we've got, I can't remember. October, we have Bill Woodburn. Who's going to be talking to us about the mind of a killer. He's a clinical psychologist. And then in November, we have Angie, I can't pronounce her last name, not me, but she's a private eye.
She spies private eye.
Yeah.
She spies private eye. And
I remembered the other one. It's Tex. Tex Thompson.
Oh my God, how could I forget? Tex Thompson, who is bigger than life. Is and very well published. She gives seminars all over the place. Big Texas kind of girl, let me tell you. She is going to be talking about how to pep up our stories, especially with getting our characters more oomph. And
She's September. She's September. She's after Lori Rader next month.
Right. So she's September. Yes. October is going to be Bill Woodburn. And November is going to be our She Spies Private Eye. And then Christmas, we'll have our Christmas party.
We may have a get together online if we can't have it in, you know,
person. I had an idea for that. We usually, you know, like eat and drink. Well, first of all, it's BYOB, so that's pretty cool. But I thought as a Christmas present to each other, maybe what we could do is just a real quick round of who's got what books so that we can give the present to each other of asking our libraries for those books.
Okay.
So, hi there, Maureen.
That's great.
So that's just some stuff we have coming up, and we're so excited that you guys are online with us, and we are already starting putting together a heck of a next year, so you are in our thoughts, believe me.
Yes, and that is, for those who don't know, this is KP Green, Vice President and Program Director.
So, all righty, so I did my thing.
Thank you. Okay. Anybody else? Any other questions? No? Yay.
Thanks, Harry. And thank
you. I forgot something, but oh well. Thank you very much, y'all.
Thank you so much, Noreen.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Bye, guys.